Well, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Seems hard to believe, 2017. I think what Ben was talking about, just the confidence that you're bound up in the bundle of the living, Scripture says. You're safe and secure in Jesus Christ. No matter what comes, what happens, you're secure, and that He cares for you. I think there's so many people who are so fear-ridden. It's just easy to have fear dominate our lives. I think be fearful of the future, of what's going to happen to our kids, our grandkids, fear about finances, fear about the unknown, fear about our jobs, fear about, and fear just dominates us instead of praise. So my prayer is that God will just give you in 2017 just a spirit of joy, that it will just fill you with joy each day as you begin to face each day and its struggles and problems, that God will just give you joy and that you'll go forward with a song. Now, that's why we sing in church. I mean, so that you have a song that you carry with you through the week. So God does give you a song and give you joy, and the people around you say, "What's wrong with you?" They'll be so surprised, because I think so many people are looking down, not just at their phones. Everybody's looking down. You notice everybody's looking down. But not just their phones. People tend to look down. Scripture says, lift up your eyes to the hills. So lift up your eyes. 2017, may it just be a glorious year. And bless you for that. Well, this is the sermon I elected to preach. I suggested this when we are going to be calling a new pastor, which I am delighted. What a privilege to be with you. I can tell you that I appreciate so much. This was longer than we thought, but it's going to be 6 months. It's going to be like 14 months. But it's been a joy to be with you. As a missionary and involved in missions and going out and coming back, and the session has given me the permission to just go and still be involved in missions and still be here with you during this transition, and hopefully to be a support and guide and help during this process with the PNC and all that stuff. So it's been a joy. But I'd like to preach on how to treat a pastor. You might say, what? Maybe you haven't heard one of those kind of sermons before, but I think it's fitting that in a couple of weeks, James Baer is going to be here and as a candidate. And he is a young pastor. This is his first called senior pastor position. And so I think it's appropriate that we take a look at this. And it's important to really consider what is a pastor? What does a pastor do? I mean, some people think that he shows up on Sunday and the rest of the week he doesn't do anything. I've had people say that, really have. But I'd like for us to look at what it really means to be a pastor, and then look at what is our response. And if there's any takeaway that you remember when you walk away from this sermon, if you remember one thing, here's the one thing I wish you would do, is pray for the pastor. Pray for this shepherd. He will need your prayers. And so that's the takeaway. If you don't forget everything else, that's it. I've recently been listening, re-listening to some of the old Garrison Keillor. Remember Garrison Keillor and Lake Wobegon? I remember that. And he talks about the Lutheran Church and Pastor Ingfest. I love the story that he tells about how that Pastor Ingfest, the cold of Lake Wobegon, there was a conference in Orlando, and he was looking forward to this conference in January to get out of the cold, and he was so looking forward to it. His wife was just, she had everything packed, and she was ready. So he went to the church board meeting. And during the discussion, seems like every time, this is my experience after a few years as a pastor, is that we're never financially okay. We always are you know. But I think that's good. I think because we have to walk by faith, you know. This is God's work, and it's not just in our confidence and whatever. But anyway, so they were talking about finances in this board meeting, and one of the elders who was one of the real concerned about the finances and trying to make sure they handle the finances right, which is good. But anyway, so he said, well, we could save some money if you didn't go to this conference. And Pastor Inkfest said, well, I guess we couldn't. He immediately jumped on that and said, okay, thanks, you're not going to go. And so Pastor Inkfest had to go back to his wife to tell his wife, we're not going to Orlando. I love that story because it so often typifies what happens in the church, and that is the pastor is feeling this pressure and whatever, and all the dynamics of that relationship. This passage that we're going to read today in Philippians is about two pastors. One is a very young pastor, Timothy, and remember Timothy was this young man, which is modern-day Turkey, but that's where he's from. And Timothy was this young pastor, and he had been discipled and led, and he was trained, whatever. But he had some problems. People didn't quite trust him because how can you trust this young pastor? Then the other pastor that Paul addresses is a pastor named Epaphroditus. I'm not sure I'd want the name Epaphroditus, but that's his name. And Epaphroditus was an old senior pastor. He was a pastor from Philippi, this city in Macedonia. Because remember, Paul had the Macedonian call. He went from Troas to Macedonians in Philippi. Remember that story? And so, anyway, Paul is now writing this from a prison. He's in prison in Rome. And Epaphroditus has come to be with Paul, sent by the church to help bring a coat and provisions, because they don't provide that in prison. And so he is there with Paul. So this is the story of these two pastors and their work of ministry, what they're called to be as pastors. And then also Scripture gives us an indication of how we are then to how to respond to a pastor and how to treat a pastor. Let's pray as we begin. Lord Jesus, as we begin today, to consider your word, and you've given us these two pastors as examples of what it means to be a pastor, to follow you, to be called by you and used by you. I pray, Lord, you'll help us to understand this in light of the new pastor that's coming in just a few weeks. So we pray that you'll help us so that we might be ready to understand this pastoral leadership responsibility that he will carry, but also to understand our part to respect and care for and support and pray for and really be a healthy church, because we have a healthy shepherd and we have a healthy flock, we together who are your church. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, talking about pastors, before I read the scripture, I grew up in a Christian home. That was before we had chairs. We had wooden benches. I know some of you remember that. And they would shellac the benches. Do you remember? And I can remember waking up with my face stuck on that bench. Because then you didn't have just Sunday morning. You had Sunday morning. You had Sunday evening, you had Wednesday night prayer meeting, you had Thursday choir. Usually there was something else during the week, I don't know. And so I grew up in the church, and my father was involved in new church development, and my grandfather was a pastor. So I've been around the church all my life. And so the one thing I decided very early on is I was not going to be a pastor. Lord has surprises for us, doesn't he? But I didn't want to be a pastor because I saw the struggles. I saw how difficult to be a pastor is. And what I begin to really understand, that the issue is because it is a spiritual battle. The enemy does not want a healthy shepherd. He does not want a healthy church. Because when it's a healthy shepherd and a healthy church, the gospel is being proclaimed. Lives are being changed. People are coming to know Jesus. And the church is open. It's a welcome place. It invites people and they feel drawn. You can feel it when you walk into a church where there's a healthy pastor, healthy elder leadership, deacons, greeters. You feel it. They're just, you know, there's something about what Christ does that changes us. That, you know, we talk about seeing about light. We become light bearers. We show the love of Jesus. And so I saw that. I didn't want to be a pastor. But then God's call on my life, and I think when we look at these two pastors, we'll see, what does it really mean? Not a job. It's not money. It's certainly not, it never is in the church about money. You don't do it for that. But it's a calling. God calls you. And here are these two men called pastors for this service. And let's look at what it is. But let's look at the scripture. This is Philippians chapter 2, verses 19 to 30. Read it with me. Let's read it together. Okay. I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, that I also may be cheered when I receive news about you. I have no one else like him who will show genuine concern for your welfare. For everyone looks out for their own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Timothy has proved himself, because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. I hope, therefore, to send him as soon as I see how things go with me. And I am confident in the Lord that I myself will come soon. But I think it is necessary to send back to you Epaphroditus, my brother, co-worker, and fellow soldier, who is also your messenger, whom you sent to take care of my needs. For he longs for all of you to is distressed because you heard he was ill. Indeed, he was ill and almost died. But God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, to spare me sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore, I am all the more eager to send him, so that when you see him again, you may be glad, and I may have less anxiety. So then, welcome him in the Lord with great joy, and honor people like him, because he almost died for the work of Christ. He risked his life to make up for the help you yourselves could not give me. Amen. Well, looking at these two pastors, I think we have some guidelines that help us understand what their work is. What is the role of a pastor? Well, first of all, as I said, Paul is trying to address this person who is bringing good news. Because he wants the church to go forward. The pastor is someone who believes in the church. When I was recently in Uganda, just a few weeks ago, I was there with those like 60 different missionaries and mission staff we were training, who were going to be going out into areas of southern Sudan, areas that we Mzungus, white people, can't go. And as I was there, I had 4 days of training, and then began that children trauma program, and watching them work with these children who were former child soldiers and sex, children who had been through such abuse. And I stood back, and I thought, this is church. This is church. This is church, because this is when the body of Christ are reaching out and touching lives, people who've been broken, abused, and traumatized, and brought to life through Jesus Christ. That's what the church is. That's what we are as a church. We are the priesthood of all. It's the priesthood of all believers. All of us are called together into this mission to bring life and light here to Paso Robles and around the world. And so Paul addresses these two pastors, and he says Timothy is qualified because of his leadership. He's shown proven his leadership. There's something about Timothy that Timothy understands the value of teamwork. Because notice that Paul was a great team person. He worked with Silas, he worked with Barnabas, he worked with John Mark, he worked with all these individuals, Epaphroditus and Timothy, all these people, because he recognized this is not a solo ministry. You're not a lone ranger as a pastor. You're working together. So the pastor who comes to be the pastor of this congregation is the person who's coming to labor with you, to encourage you, to help you discover your gifts and discover the place that you have in the work of God's kingdom, and to be able to support that and enable that and have that be honoring to the Lord. And so Timothy, he's already proven himself to be attested, he's trusted, he has his training, he's prepared. And that's the same thing for this young pastor who's coming in a few weeks before you. He's gone through the training. He's been here at this church during the formation of a church. He understands church. He understands what it means. He's gone up to seminary. He got his training. He's been serving in the church as an associate. And he's be coming to you as the senior pastor, as the lead pastor. And so he's had training, the background. This was Timothy. But Timothy, many times, was criticized because he was so young. But what I like about Timothy was Timothy was a person that he recognized that it was God's call. It was God's idea. You know, this is really important. When you recognize that our having been called by God, this is God's work. God initiates. God is the one who draws us. We would never come. We would be stuck in our sins, in our pride, in our self-sufficiency, except for the Holy Spirit has given us hearts to respond and believe. I love that phrase that the Reformer used. Regeneration precedes faith. Regeneration precedes faith. That's really important, because we need to understand that the Holy Spirit has to open our eyes, has to touch our heart, has to make us alive to recognize that we're sinners, that we need Jesus Christ. We need redemption. We need to be restored in relationship with God. And then by having believing faith, we respond. We just raise empty hands of faith and receive it. It's a gift. Well, Timothy was one of these who was trained, and he recognized that he was called by God, set apart for a particular purpose. He had worked in Corinth. He had worked in several churches already. And so here he was being prepared to be serving in this church. And so Paul hopes to join Timothy. He says, I hope to join him. But the reality is, he's not going to join him. Paul's going to die. Just a matter of days, he's going to die in prison. He's writing this last letter to this young pastor to encourage him in the work of the kingdom. No matter what happens to you, you can also be able to acknowledge that God is sovereign and God is in control and God is good. But then also he includes certain things that we need to recognize. He wants us to welcome Timothy. He says, I want you to recognize that he needs to be appreciated. I like the verse here in the New King James, verse 29. It says, receive him therefore in the Lord with gladness, and hold such men, pastors, in esteem. I looked up the word esteem. What does really esteem mean? It means respect. It means you honor. I think there are two aspects to this aspect of honor. One, you honor the office of pastor, and you honor the person. You honor the office, and you honor the person. Now, I think we live this American mentality of that this kind of developed over the years of an anti-authoritarian view. We don't like authority. I mean, it's just, we don't trust authority. We've been so disappointed with different leadership and different from the top all the way from down, and we've been disappointed with leaders, and so we don't trust leaders. We don't respect leadership. In fact, talking with Katie and Kevin about what's happening in the schools, the lack of respect for teachers. So today, I think this mentality of lack of respect for the office of pastor, this is God's idea. This is not a domineering thing. This is not a higher than thing. This is not a better than thing. This is simply a call thing. God has called certain individuals to serve as shepherds for the church. This is God's idea. This is what God set up. And so what we emphasize here in the church is a trained pastor, equipped and to be able to serve. But the pastor, it's not to put the pastor on a pedestal as if the pastor is perfect. I think some churches, the pastor is glamorized and whatever. No, the pastor is not to be glamorized, but the office is to be respected. This is God's design and God's plan. But also, I believe the word honor or respect applies to the person. Because as a young pastor, learning and growing, whatever, may in fact not have the same hairstyle that you may like, or the look the same way, or do certain things. And so often we have the pastor for lunch. We're critical. It's the things that are said in the parking lot and whatever. And so Paul says, honor the office, but he says, I want you to honor the person. This is not a superficial issue or a super spiritual issue. He says, I want you to recognize that this person is a servant. This person is here to serve. That's the role of a pastor. I recently read in one book on pastors, and it said the most important thing that people in the church want from a pastor is to feel that he accepts me. I think that's important. Why does that occur? Because a pastor is there to serve. A pastor is someone who comes alongside. The pastor is someone who's sitting beside your bedside at the hospital. The pastor is someone who's dedicating that child or baptizing that individual. The pastor is someone who marries your son or daughter or grandson or granddaughter. The pastor is someone who there through the years is there, someone that keeps things confidential, doesn't share those things. Someone who can be trusted, someone who's there to grow with you and to learn with you, who's also recognizing they don't have all the answers. They're just there in that office as pastor, trying to grow with you in Christ. Talk about leadership and talk about servanthood. Several years ago, when finally the rebels were pushed out of a town called Gulu, where the children had been formerly fleeing so they were not abducted by the rebels, they had been pushed back. And then all these children were coming into this area that had been former abducted children. And we were working with those children. It was hot and dusty and dirty. And the wind was blowing, dust was blowing. And one of the young pastors was working with this group of 14, 15-year-old boys who had been former child soldiers. And they were hard. I mean, they had been through, since being abducted when they were 7, 8 years of age, all those years in the bush with the rebels, and had done horrible things, had gone back and killed people in their own villages. I mean, just horrible things. And so Keith, this pastor, was working with this group of about a dozen, these young men. And they wouldn't participate. They wouldn't enter into stuff. And he was trying to work with them. Days went by. Finally, one hot afternoon, I mean, it had to be hot, I don't know, 100 and something. And he took the boys over to this pump, this well. And he pumped the pump. He took his T-shirt off, and he put his shirt under, and he soaked his shirt. And he asked the boys to sit down, and he began to wash their feet. And as he washed their feet, it broke. For the first time, they understood that Jesus loves them. For the first time, they could see through his leadership that he cared for them. And then it changed. Then they began to open up and tell their stories of the abuse they'd gone through. And they began to discover that a God is there who heals them and loves them. Why? Because Keith was there. He was there on that dusty afternoon in a little town called Gulu, washing the feet of these boys. He was there. That's what a pastor is. A pastor is someone who's there, someone who comes alongside and who's there with you because they care. Now, that's the same thing true of Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus, this older pastor from Philippi, who's gone from Philippi down to Rome to the prison to take warm clothing for Paul during the cold months that he's in prison and food. And while he's there, he almost dies. He gets sick. He almost dies. But he's there to minister to Paul. He's there to encourage him. One thing that I often say to the people whenever I'm in these places, where it doesn't matter if it's Chechnya or Gaza or Uganda, I'll be in Brazil working with the sex trafficking with children. And when I'm with these people, and they're working day in, day out with horrible situations, they're hearing terrible knowledge, and their heart is being broken as they're working with these people. What I say to them is, you're not alone. You're not alone. Behind me are all these people who are praying for you. You're not alone. And often the caregiver, the pastor, feels very much alone and is carrying all of these situations in confidence, and is going from a wedding with joy and celebration, and then a few hours later is at a memorial service in a graveside, and is going through all these emotional changes. So Paul says, Epaphroditus, he's a brother in Christ. He's a brother. Your pastor is your brother in Christ. He is your co-leader. He wants to encourage you to use those gifts that maybe you don't even know you have. He's that one who wants to encourage you to continue on with Jesus and to follow the Lord and trust him, even during the times when you'll be going through maybe loss or grief or sorrow or maybe any number of things. And he's the one who's there, the one who comes alongside you. And so what Paul is saying is honor the person, but also honor the office. Treat them fairly. Treat them fairly. Financially, treat them fairly. Get honest pay for honest work. And then also recognize that he needs to be respected. I think it's so easy to nitpick and to gossip. And so I want to encourage you to, this pastor, to pray for him. Pray that he will succeed. I was talking to one of the pastor nominating committee members, and their job, they recognize going on from here, is to try to help this pastor be able to succeed, be able to adjust. There's a whole lot of changes. I mean, it's going to be a different grocery stores, different dentists, doctors, his wife adjusting. I mean, all these things with the children, whatever. And so all of these things are adjustments for him. And so pray for him. Pray that God will continue to nourish him, encourage him. When he needs to get away for a pastor's conference, don't do like Pastor Inkfest, and the elders, you know, recognize that he's just a person, but he's a person who loves Jesus. And his heart's desire, the only reason why he's a pastor is because he's called. He would do anything else he could do except he is bound, led, kept by Jesus, and he wants to be a faithful pastor. And so help him to succeed. Pray for him. And then also recognize that you're in a partnership with him. You're in a partnership with him. You know, this last thing, let me say, a healthy church family has a healthy pastor, a healthy shepherd. You know, when there's a healthy shepherd and there's a healthy congregation, it's just contagious. People see it. People want to be a part of it. And so I'll be praying for you, praying that God will bless you in this new year as you go forward together, really together, in partnership, in shared responsibilities and all that goes with being the body of Christ, and the excitement, the joy of seeing what God's going to do. It's going to be an exciting year. Maybe exciting 20 years, who knows, with his pastor. But God bless you. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, oh, you're so good to us. You're so good to us. I thank you for your love for us, that it isn't for what we do, but it's because of who you are, that you've drawn us to yourself, and you love us, and you've called us to be a part of this incredible adventure called your church, your body, your family. And you've called us together, and you've set apart this person as the shepherd, as the person who's there, not the perfect person, but the person called by you. This is the office that you've set up. This is what we recognize in your word, and we ask that we'll be able to honor that office, but also be able to honor the person, so that Jesus Christ shall be praised. May it be that this church will be such a lighthouse for Jesus Christ in Paso Robles. They'll be known because of its love and commitment to you. We thank you for what you're doing and for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen.